Hello everyone, a warm welcome to Parasites and Health. From our previous lectures, you now know what parasites are and what they are capable of doing in the human hosts. They are causes of discomfort, diseases, and possibly death. But how do we get these parasites? It is normally said that parasites are ubiquitous. They are everywhere. They are in every ecosystem. They occupy every niche. They are your hands, your head, your nostrils, your oral cavity, they are your environment, in your kitchen, in your dining table, in the soil, in the air, everywhere. So, how do we get these parasites? Now, we can contact these parasites in a number of ways. Series, we're going to look critically at water and its central role, both in the transmission and the mitigation of infections caused by parasites. Soil polluted with human excreta act as a source of infection with Ascaris lumbricoides, or the common roundworm, Trichuris trichura, and Chylostoma duodenale and Necato americanus. These are the hook worms. Strongyloides tecoralis, or the thread worm. Before acquiring infectivity for man, the eggs of these parasites undergo certain development in the soil. These are known as the soil transmitted helminths, or we call them geohelminths. For Ascaris lumbricoides, the eggs are found in the soil. For the hookworms, what you find in the soil are the larvae. The infective larvae are found in the soil, and their transmission is through active penetration of intact skin. Strongyloides tecoralis, the larvae, the infective larvae are found in the soil. Strongyloides is one of the worms that are partially parasitic and partially free living, which also has an implication in epidemiology and control of the parasite. Because when you eliminate the infective form, the free living ones are in the soil reproducing. And at a certain point, when conditions are right, these free living ones will transform into parasitic ones, get to the infective stage, and then infect susceptible hosts. Trichuris trichura too has its eggs in the soil. Now, water polluted with human excreta may contain viable cysts of Enterobacter histolytica, Giardia lamblia, Balanitium coli. These are microparasites that are capable of causing infection in the large or small intestine of man. Of course, you know that Enterobacter histolytica is the causative organism of amoebiasis. Giardia lamblia causes giardiasis, or what you call traveler's diarrhea. And then Balanitium coli is mainly a parasite of pigs. It's a protozoan parasite of pigs, but it can also infect man. Remember what we said about zoonosis in our previous lecture. In addition to this, eggs of Tinea solium and Hymenonepis nana, and then the infective secondary stage of Schistosoma hematobium, Schistosoma mansoni, and Schistosoma japonicum can also be found in water. Tinea solium is the tapeworm from pigs. We get it from eating raw or partially cooked pork. We also have Tinea saginata, which is the one that you get from beef, raw beef or improperly cooked beef. For the schistosomes, their infective forms are usually found in water. I will treat schistosomiasis in a broader perspective in the course of our subsequent lectures. We also get parasites from freshwater fishes. Example, the broadfish tapeworm known as Diphyllobotrym latium, and then Chlamydis sinensis. Diphyllobotrym latium has a significant medical importance because it has a high predilection for vitamin B12. We can also get parasites from crabs and crayfish because they serve as intermediate hosts of some trematode infections, example, Paragonimus westermanni. This is a trematode that causes paragonimiasis. Well, of course, we partially mentioned raw or undercooked pork. And from there, we can get Tinea solium. Or if it is beef, you can get Tinea saginata. And then you can also get Trichinella spiralis that causes trichinosis. It is a muscle helminth and can be got from raw or undercooked meat. You also have some water plants. Example, watercress harbors on the underside of the leaf the snail intermediate host of Fasciola hepatica. Fasciola hepatica is the sheep liver fluke. It can also cause problem in man. Remember what we said about vectors, blood-sucking insects, hematophagous insects, example, mosquito species that transmit Plasmodium. We also have species of mosquitoes that transmit Wuchereria bancrofti, or those that transmit Brugia malai, Onchocerca volvulus, the trypanosomes, etc. All these insects can be found in water bodies. What about the housefly? We've talked about the role of the housefly as a mechanical vector, and it can carry cysts of intermedialytica from human excretor to a source of food. Now, what about our pet animals? Example, dog. That's a dog tapeworm called Echinococcus granulosus. Because man is not the natural host of Echinococcus granulosus, he can undergo some migration leading to what is called hydatidosis. Because it produces hydatid cysts in man that can grow until it can block some vital internal organs of the body. We also have the dog roundworm called Tozocara canis. Tozocara canis can cause larval migrants. That is, because man is not its natural host, if it gets into man, it migrates, causing some inflammatory reactions in man's anatomy until he hits a dead end, but not without causing some internal damage. We also have cats. Cats harbor Toxoplasma gondii. It's a protozoan organism and it causes toxoplasmosis. And again, cats have hookworms called Ankylostoma brasiliensis. The hookworm of dogs are called Ankylostoma canarium, and all these are capable of also infecting man, causing larval migrants. We also have cases of auto-infection that normally occurs with Enterobius vermicularis. Enterobius vermicularis is a tiny round worm known as the pin worm. It has a queer life cycle pattern, such that by scratching the anal region where the eggs are embedded, they can simply be transferred from the fingernails to the oral cavity. And because of their short life cycle, they can initiate another round of infection. It is called auto-infection. It doesn't need to go through the soil. A high public health importance though, but it has a high nuisance value in refugee camps, in dormitories, in reformatories, or where you have a high concentration cutting on our lectures here today. Have you subscribed? Please do that. We are waiting for your questions and comments in the comment section. Please don't fail to drop your comments. I'll see you again during the next lecture. Thank you so much.